egg structure. Most insects produce large eggs relative to their own size. This is due to a majority of insects packaging their eggs with large amounts of yolk, which serves as the source of nutrients for growth and development of the embryo. In general, the eggs of endopterygota contain less yolk and are smaller than those of exopterygota. To some extent, this may reflect differences associated with the ovarial type. For example, in two locust Orthoptera species which have ponostic ovarioles, each egg weighs about 0.5% of female weight. Among insects with telotropic ovarioles, the eggs of Trilorides vaporiarum hemiptera is over 1% of the female weight, and that of Classobrucis maculata coleoptera 0.6%. By contrast, among insects with polytropic ovarioles, comparable figures for Apis mellifera hymenoptera and Gramia genera lepidoptera are 0.07% and 0.11% respectively. Several ecological and life history factors have also been suggested to affect the size and morphology of insect eggs. Among Lepidoptera from temperate regions, species overwintering in the egg stage have larger eggs than species that overwinter in some other stage, and species feeding on woody plants have bigger eggs than those feeding on herbaceous plants. Individual females of at least some butterflies lay smaller eggs as they grow older, and females of the corn borer moth Austrinia lay smaller eggs if they do not receive adequate nutrition. Egg morphology of Lycaenid butterflies also varies among populations in relation to habitat. Insects such as aphids package their eggs with little or no yolk because the mother provides nutrients necessary for embryonic development. Many endoparasitic hymenoptera also package eggs with reduced amounts or no yolk because they lay their eggs inside the body of another arthropod, that is the host, which provides nutrients for both embryonic and larval development. Insect eggs have a wide variety of forms. Commonly, as in Orthoptera and many Hymenoptera, they are saugage shaped, but they may be conical, as seen for butterflies in the genus Peris, rounded other Lepidoptera, are barrel shaped as in many Hemiptera. The eggs of Nipidae Hemiptera and some Diptera have respiratory horns, while the eggs of many parasitic Hymenoptera have a projection called a pedicel, which accumulates some of the contents of the egg as it is being laid through the narrow opening of the ovipositor into a host. Major structural features of insect eggs. Most insects produce eggs containing an oocyte nucleus, cytoplasm, posterior germplasm and yolk, which is comprised of proteins, lipids and carbohydrates. Surrounding these components is the eggshell. Key features of the other components include the cytoplasm, nucleus and pole plasm, and the eggshell, which consists of several layers. At the time of oviposition, the egg cytoplasm forms a bounding layer called the periplasm and an irregular reticulum within the yolk. The oocyte nucleus surrounded by a hollow of yolk-free cytoplasm is usually located centrally within the egg, but in some species may be more anterior or posterior. The posterior pole of Dipteran, Hymenopteran and Lepidopteran eggs is frequently distinguished from the anterior pole by the presence of a pole plasma, also called germplasm. which differs from other cytoplasm in the egg because it contains specific mRNAs and proteins that determine the germ line. Symbiotic microorganisms like Wolbachia, which are transmitted vertically by insects, also often accumulate in the posterior pole of the egg. The eggshell of insects consists of three distinct layers: vitellin membrane, wax layer, and chorion, which are formed during the late stage of oogenesis. The innermost layer of the eggshell is the vitellin membrane, which is approximately 300 nanometer thick in Drosophila eggs and 1 to 2 micrometer thick in many other insects. In parasitic hymenoptera such as Herbarochon and Nosinia, the vitellin membrane is only 150 nanometer, which in the Damsfly Sympatrum it is 9 mm thick. The vitellin membrane may also vary in thickness in different parts of the egg and is not necessarily uniform in structure over the entire surface of the oocyte. In Drosophila diptera, for example, there are spaces within the vitellin membrane where the chorion splits at the time of hatching, and in the beetle Lyta, it is perforated beneath the micropyles. The vitellin envelope is the first layer of the eggshell to be made by the follicular epithelium, and its deposition usually begins late in oogenesis. When vitellin membrane proteins accumulate on the surface of the oocyte in small vesicle called vitellin bodies. A wax layer is sometimes but not always present on the outside of the vitellin envelope. This has been observed in Drosophila, the Hymenopteran, Rhodinus, Grasshoppers and some Lepidoptera. It may be of general occurrence at least among insects that lay their eggs in places where they are subject to desiccation. The wax layer is formed by accumulation of lipid filled vesicles on the surface of the vitellin envelope, which create a water impermeable layer. The chorion forms the outermost layer of the eggshell and is produced by the follicle cells which the eggs is in the ovary. The primary constituents of the chorion are proteins that undergo a hardening process either before or shortly after oviposition. The hardening process is due to the pre-oxidase catalyzed protein cross-linking. In many mosquitoes, the chorion also hardens and darkens following oviposition due to the formation of melanin catalyzed by the enzyme phenoxylase. The chorion of insect eggs varies in thickness from less than 1 mm in egg of some endoparasitic Hymenoptera to over 50 mm in some Orthopteran and Lepidopteran eggs. Even closely related species may have chorions differing in thickness. In the silk moths, for example, the chorion of Bombyx is about 25 mm thick, while that of Hylophora is 55 mm thick. These differences are presumed to have ecological significance. In some species, the chorion is subdivided into two anatomically distinct layers called the endochorion and exochorion, but in other insects, these distinct layers are absent. Even where both are present, they are not necessarily homologous in different species. In the mosquito Aedes aegypti, the endochorion is a homogeneous electrodense layer, while the exochorion consists of a fibrillar network. In Drosophila, proteins of the endochorion are grouped into octamers of four dimer pairs that are stabilized by disulfide or ditrisoin bonds. Holes in the resulting crystal lattice are 2 to 4 nanometer across, which is large enough to permit the free movement of oxygen and carbon dioxide. Extensive air spaces are usually present in the Korean adjacent to the oocyte in species that lay their eggs in moist environments. These air spaces may extend through the entire thickness of the Korean. This is the case in the Gruis loctus Textera tetrarix. In the eggs of most species, however, opening through the Korean are restricted, and this limits water loss. For example, in Musca diptera, the inner meshwork in the Korean, which provides a continuous layer of air all around the developing embryo, connects with an outer meshwork by pores, aeropiles, through an otherwise solid middle layer. In many other species, the connections are even more restricted. For example, in Calliphora, that is diptera, the outer meshwork and aeropiles connecting with the inner meshwork are absent over the greater part of the egg and are present only between the hatching lines. Eggs of Ocypus coleoptera have an equatorial band of aeropiles connecting with the inner air spaces. Rhodinus eggs have a ring of aeropiles just below the cap, and those of the stick insects Carassius have a single small pore at which the reticular inner Korean is exposed at the egg surface. The respiratory horns present on the eggs of some diptera and the Nypidae hemiptera similarly serve the function of connecting the inner layer of air with the atmosphere outside, while at the same time restricting the area through which water loss can occur. This is also true of the micropylar processes of many hemiptera, which have a respiratory function. The Korean outside the inner layer of air spaces is sometimes thick, and in Lepidoptera is often lamellate. The lamellate are formed from sheets of protein fibers that are organized in the same orientation. The orientation of fibers in successive sheets is rotated so that they have a helicoidal arrangement throughout the thickness of the Korean. Rotation through 180 degree creates the appearance of lamellae in exactly the same way as in chitinous cuticle. The outer surface of the Korean is often sculptured, frequently with a basically hexagonal pattern reflecting the shapes of the follicle cells which secrete it. Outside this, grasshoppers have an additional layer, the extracorian, which differs from the Korean in being produced by gland cells in the oviducts rather than by the follicle cells. The outer covering of the egg of the moth Micropteryx is also unusual in consisting of a forest of knobbed projections. The stalks carrying the knobs are about 50 mm high and 2 to 4 mm in diameter, and the knobs themselves are about 10 mm in diameter. These are produced in the hour following oviposition by exudation from the oocyte itself. The exudate forces the viscous outer layer of the shell produced by the female accessory glands outward to form projections. Fertilization. Because of the Korean is laid down during oogenesis, some provision is necessary to allow the entry of sperm when the egg is fertilized. This takes the form of structures called micropyles, which are funnel shaped pores usually located near the anterior pole of the egg that pass through the Korean and into which fit protuberances of the vitelline membrane. The pores are 1 to 2 mm in diameter, often with a wide funnel at the surface of the Korean. The vitelline envelope beneath the micropyle is also modified. The number of micropyles varies. Most dipteran eggs have only a single terminal micropyle, while Acrididae grasshoppers commonly have 30 to 40 arranged in a ring at the posterior end of the egg. The number of micropyles varies from 0 to 70 among species of Hemiptera, but is more or less consistent within a species. When there is a large number of micropyles, they are usually arranged in a circle around the anterior end of the egg. Among Hemiptera, most Comicoidae have two micropyles, but different species of Coriidae have between 4 and 60 and Pentomids between 10 and 70. Eggs produced by older females of Rhodinus have a reduced number of micropyles compared with those laid by younger females. There are no micropyles in the eggs of species of Sisymidae which are fertilized in the ovary. Sometimes the micropylar openings are associated with uropyles and are raised above the surface of the egg. This occurs in Heteroptera, Hemiptera. In Oncopletus, for example, each consists of a cup on a stem. The micropyle canal passes through the middle of the process and through the corion and is surrounded by an open reticulum enclosing air spaces. Respiration. Among the majority of terrestrial insects, gas exchange between the egg and the environment occurs via the aeropyles and the corion air spaces of the eggshell. The layer of air in the inner corion has direct access to the oocyte throughout pores and is also connected with the outside air via the aeropyles, where only a single aeropyle is present. As in the beetle Colossobriches, its size is critically important. Too small, a pore will not permit the entry of an adequate supply of oxygen. The eggs of two strains of Colossobriches maculatus with different metabolic rates have differently shaped aeropyles. The eggs of some terrestrial insects laid in soil are detritus, are subject to periodic flooding. Eggs of some species survive this because the corion, with its hydrophobic characteristics, maintains a layer of air around the egg into which the gas from the surrounding water may diffuse. Thus, the corion acts as a plastron, but the effectiveness of the plastron depends on the area available for gas exchange, that is, on the extent of the air-water interface. In the egg of Lepidoptera and many Hemiptera, including Rhodinus, the air-water interface is too small to be of significance since it is limited to the openings of the aeropyles. Nevertheless, these eggs may survive some degree of flooding by virtue of the fact that they can tolerate great reductions in their metabolic rate. In other insects, the plastron is large and more effective. In the blowfly Calliphora, where the plastron occurs between the hatching lines, and in the fly Musca, where it extends over the whole egg, normal development continues if the egg is immersed in well aerated water. The respiratory horns of Mandipteran eggs also form an efficient plastron if the eggs are flooded. This is also true in the eggs of Nepidae, Hemiptera, which are essentially terrestrial in their respiration as the horns normally project above the surface of the water. The surface tension of water contaminated with organic acids and other surface active substances is lower than that of clean water, and the ease within which a plastron is wetted and hence ceases to function is inversely proportional to the surface tension. Thus, the plastron of insect eggs which are laid in organic materials subject to flooding needs to have a high resistance to wetting if it is to continue functioning under conditions of low surface tension. The plastron must also be able to withstand wetting by raindrops, which momentarily may exert a pressure approaching 50 kPa. Hence, although eggs in dung and similar situations can rarely be subjected to flooding by more than a few centimeters of water, they possess a plastron capable of withstanding flooding by clean water to a much greater depth, and in some cases their resistance is greater than that exhibited by the plastron of some aquatic insects. Eggs laid in water, such as those of dragonflies, obtain their oxygen from that dissolved in the water. The chorion of these eggs generally lacks any obvious system of spaces. Oxygen passes through the solid material by diffusion. This is presumably because in the absence of any need to restrict water loss, the chorion is relatively porous. As noted above, the eggs of many endoparasitic hymenoptera are very small and possess an extremely thin chorion. The eggs of these insects also respire by uptake of oxygen from the hemolymph of their host. Water regulation. All insect eggs are subject to water loss, but the extent to which water loss occurs is affected by the choice of oviposition site and by the permeability of the chorion. Subsequently, during embryonic development and in the parrot first stage larva, water loss may be further reduced by the formation of new structures within the egg. The eggs of some insects also take up water, which is often essential for continued embryonic development. Features of the eggshell that facilitate hatching. First stage, nymphs or larvae usually emerge from the egg by either chewing through the chorion or by using specialized egg busting devices. The chorion of some species, however, has a line of weakness along which it splits. When the larval exerts pressure from within, these hatching lines are usually visible from the outside and sometimes define a cap or operculum. A cap is present in the eggs of Plasmodidia and Embryoptera, some Hemiptera and Phytophthora, and in Rhodinus Hemiptera, the cap is joined to the rest of the chorion by a sealing bar, which is formed from a very thin layer of resistant endochorion, peripars equivalent to the crystalline endochorion described above, and the thick amber colored layer. There are lines of weaknesses, hatching lines, in the amber layer above and below the sealing bar. Some pentamoid eggs also appear to have a cap, but this has the same structure as the rest of the chorion and is not joined to it by a sealing bar. The eggs of Muscoid Diptera have hatching lines in the form of two ridges running longitudinally along the length of the egg. Along these lines, the inner layer of the chorion extends outward so that each ridge contains two inner layers which are back to back, creating a line along which the chorion is relatively weak. In Drosophila melanogaster, there is a discontinuity in the endochorion where an operculum meets the body of the egg, and along this line the two parts are held together only by the thin innermost layer of the endochorion and a layer of exochorion. The vitellin envelope is also modified along this line. It is not certain how important these devices are as many species. Even some Drosophila species appear to have no weak lines in the chorion.